start introducing you to our audience. Asli Erdogan, she's a prize-winning Turkish writer, human rights activist, columnist for Özgür Gündem newspaper, a pro-Kurdish opposition daily, and a member of its advisory board. On August 16, 2016, Erdogan was detained and jailed for pre-trial detention, released on December 30, 2016. As a novelist, Asli Erdogan's first novel, Kabuk Adam, my Turkish is not the best, Crossed Man was published in 1994 and has since published 7 books. The short story, Gutenberg, received the first place prize from Deutsche Welle Radio in a 1997 competition. And the second novel, Kilmisi, Pelerin Litten, The City in Crimson Cloak, received numerous accolades abroad and has been published in English. In her writing, Kaslo Erdogan tackles controversial issues such as torture, human rights, violations in prisons, violence against women, and Kurdish rights. And you're very welcome to address us here, and you have 8 to 10 minutes to your disposal. The floor is yours.
Okay. Will you ask me questions or?
I think that if you want, you stay there and you listen to the rest of the speakers, and then we have a questions and answers afterwards. Is that okay for you?
Okay. Okay. So I just talk about my case.
Yes, you talk as you want for 8 to 10 minutes.
Okay. Next week there's going to be an award ceremony in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, go ahead.
Next week there will be an award ceremony in Amsterdam, the European Cultural Foundation Award, which is given to my work as an artist and as a writer. My second novel was also in German, the Stadt mit der roten Pelerine, and in France I've published more than 6 books. At the moment I have 6 books translated to French. But I cannot go to the ceremony because of the ban on passport. And I received Karl Tucholsky Prize back in. I was in prison that time, and the award was put in front of the prison. And I was simply detained just because my name is on the list of advisors. Totally symbolic board to a totally legal newspaper. And after 5 years, there has been many cases against the paper. And according to Turkish press law, the advisors are not responsible. So none of it was reflected. So suddenly after 5 years, my apartment was busted by the police, all my material was scattered around, I was kept in a cell for 8 days altogether, without water, 2 days in that, and all this time I was telling, look, I'm only an advisor and I have no responsibility, and then I realized everybody knows that and this is not the matter, and I'm among those 40,000 people, 50,000 arrested under these circumstances in the last month. Among them are academicians, politicians, the head of the third biggest party in Turkey, HDP, 12 parliamentarians, over 150 journalists, a few of them are writers, well-known novelists, and human rights activists. It's a very huge number. And in fact, I consider all these people, or majority of them, arrested under conditions which has nothing matching in the Turkish law. I mean, like my case, being an advisor to a legal newspaper is no reason to be arrested, even Turkish law. And I was arrested from Sivri, which is the heaviest article in Turkish law, destruction of unity of state. and it means life imprisonment. And as far as I know, from Second World War, since Second World War, no woman novelist has been tried with such a heavy sentence, which might very well be with punishment very soon. And there are some writers in Turkey at the moment where they ask for free punishments or the replacement. Such fake but they call our pieces Kafkaes, which I think is an insult to Kafka. If you look at those piles, it was a little bit of just a minute. You get horrified. And I think the worst moment was when a judge was arrested in a court hearing. I think this is the end of all law and justice. But judges themselves are every other. So I think this center will have to. In theory, of course, it is true, but concentration camps started when Gestapo and Kripo had the right to detain people. And today, in today's Turkey, judges have basically nothing to say about almost like being in a concentration camp. I was pressed with a book. And they are clearly telling me, we'll keep you as long as we want, perhaps lifetime, perhaps 3 months. And the life of an intellectual, many tens of thousands of intellectuals, perhaps for a power game or for bargaining. And I think the whole world actually sees that and puts that, and it's very clean, very open. There are many European organizations coming, watching what happens in the referendum. The United Nations reports about what happened in the Southeast. I just had one article about that, and probably that's what made people so angry. Everything is very clear and open. And 74 new prisons are being built. Only yesterday, 400 people lost their jobs, just on the phone. Ah, I think it's over 100,000 now. And still, there is a, I don't know, some sort of trick playing the free market. And I'm, of course, even at this moment, I know every word I tell you can end up in prison tomorrow. And knowing that, I speak, watching my words, watching my sentences. But the situation is alarming and embarrassing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can we come back to you, sit down and listen to the rest of the speakers, and then you can answer the questions. I hope that we the technology functions so you can listen also. This is bugünlerde her gün aynı güne kullanıyoruz. Bugün tam 184 gün oldu. Ömürlerini daha demokratik bir ülkede yaşamak için objektif ve bağımsız gazetecilik yapmaya adamış, her türlü teröre cesaretle karşı durmuş yakınları en absürt ve akıl dışı suçlamalarla cezaevinde esir ve tecrit altında tutuluyorlar. Bir gazete düşünür ki her gün cezaevine farklı bir çalışanı için, görüş günü için servis kaldırıyor. Ve her gün sağ üst köşede yayınladığı bir sayaçla kaç gündür özgürlüklerinden, sevdiklerinden ve kalemlerinden yoksun olduklarını gösteriyor. Üzüntüyle iç içe geçmiş öfkemizi tarif etmek çok kolay değil. Ve bu süreçte çocuklarımız bile hayatın acemiliğini üzerlerinden attılar. 12 sene önce dönemin başbakanı eşi Musa Kart'ın bir karikatüründe kedi olarak çizildiği için onu mahkemeye vermişti. Bu dava bugün basın ve ifade özgürlüğünde geldiğimiz dehşet verici tablonun belki de ilk işaretiydi, kim bilir. Bildiğiniz gibi Türkiye çok zorlu, siyasal bir dönemden geçiyor. 15 Temmuz 2016'daki darbe girişiminin siyasi ayağı da dahil olmak üzere tüm sorumlularını ortaya çıkaracak ciddi bir hukuki sürece girilmesi gerekirken, bu süreç iktidar tarafından olağanüstü hal uygulamalarıyla bir muhalif avı fırsatına dönüştürüldü. Eşimin deyişiyle daha önceden hazırlanmış bir torbaya ne kadar muhalif varsa atıldı. Ve onun da uzun yıllardır çizeri olduğu Cumhuriyet Gazetesi'ni susturma amaçlı siyasi bir operasyon başlatıldı. Cumhuriyet Gazetesi, laikliği, demokrasiyi, insan hak ve özgürlüklerinin temel alan yayın ilkeleriyle bağımsız ve objektif bir gazetedir. Başka hiçbir sesi olmayan insanların sesidir. Bu nedenle yayın hayatı boyunca baskıya, suikastlere, hapisliklere uğramış ama boyun eğmemiştir. Gazetenin yazar, çizer ve yöneticileri tutuklandıktan tam 5,5 ay sonra çıkan iddianamedeki trajikomik suçlamalara baktığınızda hukuki nitelikte hiçbir somut delil göremiyorsunuz. Gazetecilik faaliyetleri zorlama yorumlarla terör örgütleriyle ilişkilendirilip, objektif haberlerde devleti ve Cumhurbaşkanı'nı kötüleme çabası olarak değerlendiriliyor. Bugün Türkiye'de benden olmayanlar terörist zihniyeti ifade özgürlüğünü maalesef yok etmiştir. Verilmek istenen mesaj şudur: benim istemediğim haberi yapamazsın. Muhalif ve cesur duruşun başına dert. Özetle bugün yargı mekanizması adaletin yerine korkunun kaynağı olmuştur. Medyası özgür olmayan, yargısı bağımsız olmayan bir ülkede demokrasi ve hukuk devletinden bahsedemeyiz. Derler ki, durgun sularda usta denize yetişmez. Bizim ülkemizde de sular hiç durulmuyor. Onlar da birer usta denizci olarak, usta gazeteci olarak güçlerinin yaptıkları işe olan inançlarından olurlar. Bizler mesleğinin ve insanlık onurunu, hakkını veren yakınlarımızla gurur duyuyoruz. Musa'nın cezaevinden yolladığı son mesaj şöyle: 24 Temmuz 2017'de 9 ay tutuklu kaldıktan sonra hakim karşısına çıkaracağız. Yani önce ceza, sonra savunma. Eğer bu sıralamayı garip bulmazsanız bir hukuk devleti olduğunuzu düşünebilirsiniz. 35 yıldır sadece karikatür çiziyor ve hakkında 29 yıla varan hapis cezası isteniyor. Evet, şaka değil. Belki de bugün, bugüne kadar böyle çarpıcı, vurucu bir espri yapamadığım için cezalandırılmayı hak ettim. Musa'nın hayatının en yakın tanığı olarak söyleyebilirim ki, o mesleğini büyük bir tutkuyla ve saygıyla yaptı. Gördüğü bütün antidemokratik uygulamaları, haksızlıkları, hukuksuzlukları her iktidar döneminde korkmadan çizdi. Yani bir mizah ustası ne yapması gerekiyorsa onu yaptı. Ama bu iktidar mizahı ve eleştiriyi affetmedi. Kendi yöntemleriyle Musa Kart gibi aydınları cezalandırmayı seçti. Muhalefet ve özgür basın hiçbir dönem bu kadar yoğun bir baskı ve tehditle karşılaşmadı. İki ayda bir olan açık görüş hakkımız geçen cuma günüydü. 2,5 yaşındaki torunum Deniz, dedesini ziyaret etti. Silivri cezaevi içindeki kontrol kapılarında, servis araçlarında, bekleme salonlarında, saatlerce süren bekleyişleri, Deniz için bir saklanmaç oyununa çevirmeye çalıştı. Annesiyle sırayla yanından geçtiğimiz duvarların arkasında saklanıyormuş diye yaparak güldürdük onu. Dedesine de bahsettik oyunumuzdan. Bir dakika gibi geçen bir saat sonunda dedesini almaya geldiler. Dedesi gülerek, şimdi de beni saklıyorlar Deniz'de. Sertçe kapanan kapının ardından şaşkınlıkla bakan torunumun kulağına fısıldadı. Merak etme, onu bulacağız. Yerini sadece biz değil, bütün dünya. Hepinizin bildiği gibi Cumhuriyet Gazetesi'nin 12 yıllar da çizerlerin kısa notları katkılarından dolayı çok teşekkür ediyorlar. Sırasıyla başlamak istiyorum. Gazeteci Ahmet Şık. Hiçbir toplum bir ada değildir. Demokratik değerlere sahip çıkılmasına her zamankinden daha çok ihtiyaç var. Kadri Gürsel. Terör örgütüne üye olmamakla birlikte bilerek ve isteyerek yardım etme suçlamasıyla tutuklandım. Gerçek suçumun ise gazetedeki köşemde ve konuşmalarında iktidarın baskıcı, politik ve pratik tutumunu eleştirmek olduğunu biliyorum. Tutukluluğum ağır bir insan hakları ihlalidir. Serbest bırakılmazsam hakim karşısına tam 9 ay sonra çıkacağım. Maruz kaldığım ihlal daha da ağırlaşacak. Gazeteci Hakan Kara'nın eşi Sinem Kara. 31 Ekim 2016'dan beri hem tutuklu yazarlarımızın hem de dolaylı olarak ailelerinin özgürlükleri ellerinden alındı. Söylenecek çok şey olmasına karşın asıl olan tek bir şey var. Bu haksız tutukluluk süreci Hakan Kara ve diğer 11 arkadaşı için bir an önce bitmeli ve acil olarak tahliye edilmelidir. Akın Atalay'ın eşi Adalet Dinamit. Eşim Akın Atalay, Avrupa Parlamentosu'nda 31 Ocak 2012 yılında yapılan toplantıya gelmiş ve bir konuşma yapmıştı. Ergenekon ve Oda TV davalarındaki tutsuzlukları anlatmıştı. O gün o kişiler kendisine tehditler yağdırıyordu. Çelişkiye bakınız ki, şimdi de o hukuksuzlukları yapanlara yardım ettiği iddiasıyla yargılanıyor. Cumhuriyet Gazetesi, tutuklu gazetecileri, hayatları boyunca barışa, basın özgürlüğüne, demokrasiye inanmış, bunlar için mücadele etmiş kişilerdir. Bu değerler söz konusu olduğunda artık dünyada ülkelerin siyasi sınırlarından bahsedilemez. Bu insanlar şiddetle, terörle bir arada anılamaz. Bu yüzden sizden istediğimiz şimdi Türkiye'yi yalnız bırakmayın. Önder Çelik'in eşi Semra Çelik. Ülkemizde sesimizi yükseltmemize, duyurma imkanları çok kısıtlı. Sizlerden bizim sesimiz olmamızı, bizim sesimizi dünyanın demokratlarına, vicdan sahibi insanlarına duyurmamızı istiyoruz. Buna ekmek kadar, su kadar ihtiyacımız olduğunu bilmenizi istiyoruz. Hepinize şimdiden teşekkür ederim. Murat Sabuncu. Biliyorum, inanıyorum, memleketimde bir gün çok da uzak olmayan bir tarihte her görüşten insan omuz omuza barış içinde kimseyi ötekileştirmeden bir arada yaşayacak. O zaman Silivri Cezaevi bir demokrasi müzesi olacak. Çekilen acıların, verilen mücadelenin yüksek duvarlara, dikenli tellere asılı olduğu bir müze. Ülkede fikir ve ifade özgürlüğünden tutuklananlar yalnızca biz değiliz. Bu durumda olan herkes için adil ve tutuksuz yargılama istiyorum. Silivri'den selamlar. Güray Öz, evrensel insan hakları konusunda uluslararası danışmanın önemi sınır tanımaz. Maalesef Türk hükümetinin yasaklar konusunda sınır tanımadığını görmekteyiz. Son örneği Wikipedia'nın yasaklanmasıdır. Yapılacak bir tek şey var. Basın özgürlüğü konusunda asla taviz vermedi. Bülent Utku, İnsan hakları, demokrasi ve hukuk devleti için mücadelemiz sürecek, kralına teslim olmayacağız. Mustafa Kemal Büyük, dayanışma için çok teşekkür ederiz. Avrupa İnsan Hakları Mahkemesi'nden öncelikli inceleme kararı verildi ve nihai karar verilecek. Kararın sadece bizim değil, evrensel basın özgürlüğü açısından paha biçilmez değerini biliyoruz. Turhan Günay, kendi ülkemizde duyuramadığınız sesiniz olduğunuz için çok teşekkür ederiz. Özgür günlerde görüşmek dileğiyle. Tekrar teşekkür ederiz.
Closely with the families and legal teams of detained writers, monitoring trials at the domestic level and raising their cases through national and international advocacy. Today I've been asked to speak about the legal situation of those journalists, in particular those who have filed cases before the European Human Rights in Strasbourg. Let me start by giving an overview of the legal context, which is most pertinent to the cases of the detained writers in Turkey. I'll then outline the legal situation of those detained journalists with respect to their cases domestically and before Strasbourg, and I'll conclude by laying out some possible scenarios for what happens next, along with some of our recommendations. As you'll be aware, the detained journalists and media workers in Turkey, some 150 to 160 at this moment, find themselves in a legal system which has been designed with terrifying speed since the 15th of July. What judicial independence existed prior to the coup has been eviscerated as the courts are packed with political appointees, and the legal system itself, parts of which have long been used to judicially harass independent voices, have been transformed full-scale into a system of repression characterised by the Council of Europe's Human Rights Commissioner, Niels Nusnitz, as the judiciary playing a central role in the deterioration of press freedom. As all of us working in free expression will know, prior to the coup, the judicial treatment of journalists was by no means exemplary. It has been in sharp decline since 2011, but it was characterised by a certain level of judicial independence. In February 2016, for example, John Dündar and Ertan Gül famously were ordered to be released from solitary confinement by the Turkish Constitutional Court, who had ruled that their rights to personal liberty and security had been violated. President Erdogan, who had intervened personally in the case, responded by criticising the Constitutional Court sharply, questioning its existence and legitimacy, not for the first time. The series of emergency decrees adopted since the 15th July have been characterised by new states as bestowing very far-reaching, almost unlimited discretionary powers for administrative authorities and the executive in many areas by derogation from general principles of the law and human rights, and those safeguards ordinarily applicable in a democratic society. The judicial system itself has come under extraordinary attack. As many of you know, more than 3,500 judges and prosecutors have been permanently dismissed for their ties to FETÖ. Arrests have taken place for over 2,000 prosecutors and judges, including 104 judges from the High Court, 41 from the Appeals Court, 2 Supreme Court judges, and 2 from the High Council of Judges and Prosecutors. A further 6,000 academics, including many scholars and critics, have also lost their jobs. Since the coup, the Turkish Constitutional Court has been particularly conspicuous in its silence and has presented a crucial challenge for the detained journalists. In August, the Turkish Constitutional Court dismissed 2 of its own justices, both of whom formed part of the majority judgment who had ruled to release Dündar and Gül back in February, in a unanimous decision by members of the court who decided that the two were connected to the FETÖ PYD. In the case of Judge Aydın Ake, who also serves as a UN judge, Turkey has rejected appeals made on behalf of the UN Secretary General for his full diplomatic immunity. He remains in detention. The other opening of the Turkish Constitutional Court has now been filled by Erdogan's personal advisor. In autumn, the Constitutional Court chose to pursue a handoff approach to the emergency decrees, known as OHA, dismissing its long-standing jurisdiction and applying a literal interpretation of Article 48 of the Turkish Constitution, which situates the state of emergency outside the scope of the state under the law. In doing so, it has dismissed 4 landmark decisions the court had made in the 90s and 2003, where it had established various limiting criteria emergency decrees have to fulfill, which reasoned that if these criteria are not met, the decrees are ordinary and could be subject to constitutional review. In its decisions of October and November, the Constitutional Court unanimously rejected applications claiming the unconstitutionality of 4 of the OHAL decrees. The Constitutional Court's approach in these decisions will have severe consequences under the new post-referendum system. The authority to declare a state of emergency will only belong to the President, and by rejecting its former jurisdiction, the Constitutional Court has obstructed its own ability to check emergency decrees in the long term, giving the executive almost limitless discretionary power in times of emergency. Thus, since the purge cases began to reach the court about 7 months ago, the court has not ruled on a single application. There are currently 100,000 cases related to the decrees pending. Of these, some are on behalf of the people in jail, and these are the criminal cases, and then there are those who have lost their jobs, the administrative cases. As you will know, the amendments passed under the contested constitutional referendum of April 16 further gravely compromised the independence of the judiciary and the due process rights of the detained journalists. One amendment with immediate effect is President Erdogan's increased authority over the body that administers the judiciary and controls the appointment of judges and prosecutors, which will further strengthen executive control of the constitutional court and the wider judiciary. Last week, it was announced that 900 new judges had been appointed prior to the constitutional referendum, although it was only announced that they had been appointed afterwards. Of the 800 out of 900 are AKP party members. In the long term, the modifications will have a profound effect on the Turkish constitutional court, severely curtailing its ability to serve as an effective check of executive and legislative power and as guarantor of fundamental rights and freedoms. The amendments perpetuate executive dominance and hint at a sustainable state of emergency in which Turkey will be governed mostly by executive decrees. The referendum amendments enshrine in the Turkish constitution measures that are severely damaging to the rule of law and therefore the quality of justice that the detained journalists can expect to face in Turkey in the long term. So it is in this legal context that the cases of detained journalists and the challenges facing their legal teams can be understood. In terms of their cases, I wanted to talk about two main issues which have been mentioned by Asli and Selin. The first is the use of the penal code against journalists, and the second is pre-trial detention. While the emergency decree laws did not modify the provisions of the penal code, in practice, the criminal prosecutions of journalists have dramatically intensified. In particular, prosecutions under the headings of membership of illegal armed organisations, terrorist propaganda, acting on behalf of these organisations have become used to prosecute many of the journalists in detention today. As he also mentioned, the charge of destruction of the Turkish state, which many journalists are facing. By conflating the content of their writings with their affiliation, these journalists have been prosecuted and placed in detention as members of various terrorist groups, exclusively on the basis of their political writings. So in effect, if you write about the PKK, you can be a member of the PKK. Right about the Gulen movement, a member of the Gulen of Fatah. Successive international observers from the France of Europe, from the UN, from the Venice Commission criticized these charges as dangerously vague. And they've insisted that these crimes should not be applied to the journalists, where the only act imputed to them is the content of the publications. The Turkish government, in turn, continues to respond to this type of criticism by maintaining that these journalists have been detained not because they are journalists, but for being members of terrorist organisations or for making propaganda in favour. Turning then to the use of pre-trial detention against journalists and terror charges, which this parliament condemned in its October 2016 resolution. Arrested journalists have remained in the dark for months about specific reasons for their arrests and continuing detention. Until the recent publication of indictments in some cases, the only information available is the stereotype reference act of provisions and anti-terror rules, which served as the legal grounds for the prosecution and detention. And some of you may have seen some of the indictments which were wholescale copy and pasted from one journalist and applied to others. Detentions have been based overwhelmingly on secret materials available only to the prosecution. And since Article 5.2 of the ECHR...
Has ever been taken to court before, never been sentenced, not even investigated. So, there is not a single line I have written ever about PKK or any other organization. I am a writer of literature, translated to more than 30 languages, winner of 15 awards, and I'm accused of being a terrorist. This is outrageous, and there is nothing much I have written about, the promoting violence. On the contrary, I denounced all sorts of violence, primarily the state violence. And my arrestation has actually been an act of terror. This was to terrorize the society. I was not only arrested, but I was arrested from 302, destruction of the unity of the state, which asked for, in fact, lifelong imprisonment in a solitary cell. I'm as if I have been the founder of PKK. simply because I'm on the advisor board. I'm the literary advisor of a small newspaper. Along with me on the stand is Raghav Sarakulu, who was also a candidate for Nobel Peace Prize. So, I think this kind of sentences that we are a bit biased is very, very unfair to us. There are more than 150 journalists in jail at the moment, and hundreds more on trial. And the numbers are speaking for itself. And in fact, we are facing enormous risks with every state we make, with our every effort to reach to you. In fact, my voice, I'm an 18-year-old columnist. My column has been a bestseller in France at the moment. And I'm not published in Turkey. I'm afraid simply to publish my literary work in Turkey. But next day, maybe I'll find myself in Europe. And what should Europe do? I can't really answer this question, honestly. I'm not a politician. I'm only a literary writer. I believe in solidarity, and I believe in these concepts, in the freedom of speech and expression. And if I don't have freedom of speech or expression, someone else there has no freedom to live. Because I was detained simply because I wrote about deaths and murders. I wrote on behalf of the victim, those eternally silenced victims, and they are thousands. The report, United Nations reports are saying those victims are in thousands. And I tried to be their voice, and now I'm another victim. So all I want, all I ask from you is to hear, try to hear, that voice a bit. And what else can what you can impose for Turkey to respect human rights? Unfortunately, I have no answer to that. Thank you very much for your listening to me.
Those we can see here, I really hope that we also can help those we can't see because their faces are today not on the posters. And I also hope that we can strengthen those people who are doing actively work on solidarity in Turkey, because this requires, as you could see when you listen to us, the Erdogan via Skype right now, this requires a lot of courage and a lot of strength. So, Andrew, thank you for your work. Yes, I guess we have to continue.
Thanks to you, we are all standing here today. And I think why it is important on the eve of International Press Freedom Day to have this exhibition in the Parliament is for the reason that these are the corridors where on a daily basis, thousands of politicians from 28 member states are crossing. Lobbyists, ambassadors, world leaders. And by reading the story of these people, who are simply doing their job, because that's the reason they're imprisoned. I hope that having the exhibition here, and I know the exhibition will be traveling around Europe, we can reach thousands of people and make them aware that it's not about numbers, it's about people. So people on a daily basis fighting for the democratic future of their country. And it's very important that we stand here in solidarity with them. So thank you all for coming, and the floor is yours, Andrew.
Thank you. Thanks to both of you. I've been asked to say a few words, and I assure you they will be a few. Fewer than I usually say, about this exhibition and explain really what the thinking was behind it. Well, at one level, it really couldn't be any simpler. The people in front of you, beside you, that you'll walk around and meet, are just a few of the, we calculate, 165 journalists who are now behind bars in Turkey. And of course, terrible thing, as you've just been hearing, is that the people who have been, who are behind jail, or who are in jail, have really not been convicted of anything, let alone anything terrible. Most of them, as you've heard, have spent months really waiting to hear an indictment, to actually hear what the prosecutor is accusing them of having done. It's so bizarre to try and explain the atmosphere where suddenly the prosecutor produces this 280-page indictment, of which maybe 3 pages is actually has anything to do with the person being charged. And of course, this is an occasion for rejoicing, because it means that the person will actually get to court and will actually be able to answer the criticisms against him or her. And yet, this is an absurdity that people should feel good about hearing the most ludicrous charges being presented against them. I mean, I've seen the expression on Turkish lawyers' faces when they read the indictment, and they sort of feel insulted because the charges are so badly framed, so it's sort of guilt by association. I mean, one of the, you know, you'll read about you know, someone is facing a charge for having written about genetic rice. Another person is in jail because they had the police found a $1 bill in their wife's wallet. Now the $1, of course, was meant to be the carrying card of the Gulenist coup makers, but I did the maths, and if you figure out how many F-series dollar bills there are in circulation, does anyone have a guess? I think there's about 1.4 billion F-series dollar bills, which means that if you have a dollar bill and it's not an F-series, then you probably changed it deliberately. You know, it's the statistical odds of not having one are greater than the odds of having one. We've seen indictments which have been written, they've been cut and pasted from other indictments, and the prosecutors forgot to put the right name. they have the name from the old indictment in the charge. So it's not as if these people are being really seriously accused of having done anything. So why are they behind bars? Well, you know, I did political theory at university, and we came up with 3 reasons why people go to jail. And one of them is to stop them from harming people. The other reason is as a lesson to people who would harm people. And the third is because these are people who have offended, our natural sense of justice so terribly that society somehow demands that they be punished. But of course, in this case, it's really just the opposite. Who are these people harming? They're harming the people who really don't want us to think into question. And the deterrent that they provide is really to other people who want to think and to question. And of course, the natural sense of justice which they are violating is not them violating, it is the fact that they are the recipients of this injustice. So this is really justice turned on its head. It's Kafkaesque, except Asla Erdogan said that even Kafka would find it too trivial to even write about it. It's an insult to Kafka to call it Kafkaesque. You'll go around this exhibition, I hope, and you can read some of the stories about the people. The point was made very, very forcibly in the panel we just came from, that really these people are not being punished by the legal system, they are being punished at the first contact. So they're taken into custody, their lives are disrupted, they're held in police custody in the case of, for example, Ahmet Altan. He was arrested deliberately before a public holiday, kept in a police holding cell for 12 days or 14 days before he could actually even appear before a judge. So they were held incommunicado, for weeks. So these people are spending months and months in jail. And that really is their punishment. So it's not the legal system that is punishing them. It's not the legal system deciding that they should be punished or deliberating that they have done some crime. It's the legal system being exploited to punish them. And that, of course, is a terrible thing. So, you know, Katya and Rebecca said, the idea is that you should go around and you should really meet these people and see that if they're not, you know, abstract people. I remember covering my first, you know, refugee crisis and, you know, as a journalist climbing up a mountain in Iraq and there were hundreds of thousands of people coming in my direction. And of course, I'd only ever seen refugees on television. You sort of think, well, that's what they are. They're professional refugees. That's what they do for a living, is they upset our consciousness, our consciences. But these are not professional jail people. These are fathers, mothers, you know, brothers, friends, lots of friends. And, you know, it's important that we see them as people and not as symbols. By coincidence, I'm standing in front of Aishinur Paidalak. She's only 26 years old. She is a law student, a court correspondent, and of course found herself in prison, facing 15 years imprisonment. Of course, the good news is that she's now out of jail today.
So suddenly, after 5 years, my apartment was busted by police, all my material was scattered around, I was kept in a cell for 8 days altogether, without water, 2 days in that time. All this time I was telling, look, I'm only an advisor and I have more responsibility. And then I realized everybody knows that, and this is not the matter. And I'm among those 40,000 people, 50 more than arrested under these circumstances in the last month. Among them are academicians, politicians, the head of the third biggest party in Turkey, HDP, 12 parliamentarians, over 150 journalists, a few of them are writers, well-known novelists, and human rights activists. It's a very huge number. And in fact, I consider all these people, or majority of them, arrested in their conditions, which is, has nothing matching in the Turkish law. I mean, like my case, being an advisor to an illegal newspaper is no reason to be arrested, even Turkish law. And I was arrested from CEO, which is the heaviest article in Turkish law, destruction of unity of state. And it means life in prison. And as far as I know, from Second World War, since Second World War, no woman novelist has been tried with such a heavy sentence, which might very well be punishment very soon. And there are some writers in Turkey at the moment where they ask for three punishments or the replacement. Such great but they call our cases Kafkaesque, which I think is an insult to Kafka. If you look at those files, it was a little bit of just 10 minutes, you get horrified. And I think the worst moment was when a judge was arrested in a court hearing. I think this is the end of all law and justice. But judges themselves can be arrested. So I think this concentration camp in theory, of course, it's true, but I mean, concentration camps started when Gestapo and Kripo had the right to detain people. And today, in today's Turkey, judges have basically nothing to say about I almost like being in a concentration camp. I was pressed with people, and they are clearly telling me, we will keep you as long as we want, perhaps lifetime, perhaps 3 months. And the life of an intellectual, many tens of thousands of intellectuals, perhaps for a power game or for bargaining. And I think the whole world actually sees that and puts that, and it's very clean, very open. There are many European organizations coming, watching what happened in the referendum. The United Nations reports about what happened in the Southeast. I just had one article about that, and probably that's what many people saw. I'm angry. Everything is very clear and open. And 74 new prisons are being built. Only yesterday, 400 people lost their jobs just from up. I think it's over 100,000 now. And still, there is a, I don't know, some sort of stay in the 3 months. And I'm, of course, even at this moment, I know every word I tell you can end up in prison tomorrow. And knowing that, I speak, watching my words, watching my sentences. But the situation is alarming and embarrassing.